everybody, good morning and welcome to Cornerstone United Methodist Church. My name is Andy Unger and these are the announcements on Sunday, June 26th. We're serving with the Bridging the Gap Summer Lunch Program once again this year. We're going to meet at Eastgate at 11:45 a.m. to distribute lunches both tomorrow and Wednesday. We'll be done around 1:30 p.m. on both days. Email Andy or Gail Churchill and let them know that you are available. Saturday, July 23rd is the O'Rourke Ministry Summer Fun Breakfast Event at Eastgate from 10 to 11 a.m. We're going to be serving Chick-fil-A chicken biscuits, juice, and other breakfast items. We'll also distribute food items for those families. That brings me to the next topic. We're going to be collecting things like peanut butter, jelly, snack items, cereal, and drinks for these food bags. And if you'd like to help us with this, you can drop any of those items off in the narthex. If you want to come and hang out with us, you can meet us at the church at 9:30 a.m. on July 23rd or at Eastgate at 10 a.m. The Youth Beach Retreat is coming up in a few weeks and we need signups. We also need chaperones and drivers as well. The dates are July 8th through the 11th in Panama City. The cost is $225 and includes all but two meals that are going to be on the road. You can sign up by talking to me. Do you wish you could get all of this information but not so loud? Yeah, right. We've got an email of the happenings that is delivered weekly to your email inbox. If you would like to get these emails or you signed up a while back and haven't gotten them yet, email Janet at this email below. It's never too early to collect for Operation Christmas Child. Our church will take donations from a different item each month. For the months of June and July, we're collecting school supplies like crayons, colored pencils, pencil pouches, and then hygiene items like bar soaps, toothbrushes, or washcloths. The donations will be used at the packing party in November. There's a collection basket located in the narthex. If you have any questions, please contact Katie Brown. Y'all, we're just over a month away from our second annual End of Summer Splash Bash. Yeah, that's right. We're going to be having games for the kids, bounce houses, water events, and of course, what Methodist event wouldn't be happening without food? Yeah. This will also be the first event to welcome officially our new Pastor Brian Germano. So see you there. Y'all, we just have seven more days until our new pastor gets here. Pastor Brian Germano will be here next Sunday, July 3rd. So you're going to want to get your butts into those seats at the 9 o'clock or the 11 o'clock services. So come on out. Let's give him our support and welcome him here. Give him a good Cornerstone welcome. Y'all know what time it is. We love our congregation so much here at Cornerstone. All of these people are having birthdays and we want to wish them a very happy birthday, very happy birthday. Yeah, all those people, happy birthday. Thank you so much for watching. We're so glad you're joining us here at Cornerstone. Take a moment and let us know that you're here. You can do that by going to Church Connect and checking in, or if you prefer the old-fashioned way, grab the pew pad at the end of the aisle and fill out your information there. Now, let's get ready for worship.
Good morning. It's good to see you this morning as we come to worship God in spirit and truth. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Oh God, we trust in your power. Even as it is often found in our weaknesses. Even as it is expressed in seeming foolishness. In your wholeness. Even as it comes to us amid our brokenness. We do not ask this day for dazzling displays of strength. Electric exercises of intellectual proudness. We come simply to worship you. touch us today. Oh Lord, sinners that we are, that we might become your saints, your body, your children, your church. For this temple of your spirit is built not upon our own abilities, knowledge, or restorative skills, but upon you and Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us begin our worship.
Before we get started, why don't everyone stand up and say hey to each other? you sing that out with me?
Wherever you lead me, whatever it costs me, all I want is you. Jesus, all I want is you.
Sometimes it's super easy to sing that you'll follow him anywhere and, or say it, but sometimes it's actually not easy to physically do that. So, you know, sometimes we need a little help, and it's okay to ask God to guide us and lead us on.
This is my worship, this is my offering. In every moment, I withhold nothing. I'm learning to trust you, even when I can't see it. And even in suffering, I have to believe it. If you say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. And when you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. I don't wanna follow my own ways. I'm done chasing feelings. It felt like a burden, but once I could grasp it, you took me further, further than I was asking. And simply to see you, it's worth it all. My life is an altar, let your fire fall. Say it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're in it with me, I'll begin. And when you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. Teach me how to follow in your ways. I'm done chasing feelings. Spirit, lead me. Spirit, lead me. When all hope is gone and the word is all I've got, I have to believe. Still bring water from the rock to satisfy my thirst, to love me at my worst. And even when I don't remember, You remind me of my worth. I don't trust my ways. I've traded in my thoughts. I lay down everything, 'cause you're all that I want. I planted on my knees. This is the cup you have for me. And even when it don't make sense, really do need help. Spirit, lead me. Let's all sing it out. Spirit, lead me. Spirit, it's wrong, then I'll say no. If you say release, I'm letting go. If you're running with me, I'll begin. And when you say to jump, I'm diving in. If you say be still, then I will wait. If you say to trust, I will obey. You're the only truth, the life, the way. I'm done chasing feelings. Spirit, follow you. I will follow you. No turning back. No turning back. No turning back. No turning back.
This is my heart cry, though none go with me. The cross before me, the world behind me. This is my heart cry, though none go with me. The cross before me, the world behind me.
I will follow you.
I have decided. I have decided
I will follow you.
I have decided
I no turning back. No turning back. No turning back. No turning back.
This is my anthem, my life for your fame. My every move bring glory to your name. This is my anthem, my life for your fame. My every move bring glory to your name.
I will follow you.
I have decided.
It's a choice.
I have decided.
I will follow. Turning back, no turning back.
before me, the world behind me. I will follow, I will follow. The cross before me, the world behind me. I will follow, yeah, I will follow. The cross before me, the world behind me. I will follow, I will follow. The cross before me, the world behind me. I will follow, I will follow. No turning back,
no turning back, no turning back.
Are there any prayer concerns anyone has this morning? Have a seat. Be comfortable. Any prayer concerns that we need to lift up? I think we need to lift, and I'm not taking a stance, I'm just saying we need to lift our country up, our women's rights for their health purposes. I'm not sure what we've done, but I am aware of women who medically wouldn't have lived if they hadn't been able to have an abortion. And we need to pray. Some common sense has to be entered into the decisions being made. And that is a concern. I've had a lot of church members through the years. My wife lost twins, and the second one was aborted. It was already dead. And we need to be in prayer for folks and for the decisions being made. Just ask you to be in prayer about it. I don't think it's a form of birth control, but I do think it's a medical procedure that saves lives. And I ask you to be in prayer for those who may face those situations in the days to come. Anybody else? Okay, pray for your new preacher. You know what? I've entered into churches, and I was hoping they were praying for me. And sometimes I wasn't sure. So I'm going to ask you to purposely pray for your new preacher, for him to mesh with you and you to mesh with him and be in ministry together, working together to build God's kingdom. That's a small thing, but it can be a big thing. So be in prayer for Brian and the church as you move forward in these days to come. This church has tremendous potential, but you have to work together to make it, and you got to let God guide you. I can remember 17 years ago today, 16, I thought it was 17. It was 2005. Our anniversary was my first Sunday at this church, and Sue Brown, who was the organist, played the piece that she played at our wedding when Julie came into the church. And it meant a lot. And I knew the church was with me and praying for me, and I was praying for them. And despite differences, we became a team of ministry. And I'm thankful for that, and that's what I pray for Brian now and for you. You become a team in ministry to this community and have an effect that changes the community in a positive way. Any other prayer concerns? Let's bow our heads then. gracious and loving Creator. Sometimes the words are just not there. God, you're so amazing that our words and thoughts of how best to praise you pale in comparison to the splendors of your name. You're the Almighty, you're the Redeemer, you're the grace that never ends, the embodiment of love itself. And when we come to you in prayer, sometimes words fail us in what we should say. You know, we lift our concerns, and sometimes they seem so small in comparison to the tribulations that we encounter across your creation. How can our problems compare to the disasters people face, or the fighting that surrounds people trying to escape, or the horrors that no child should ever experience? Lord God, sometimes when we come to you to pray, we're clueless as to what we should ask for. You know the thoughts in our minds and the desires of our hearts, and there are times when they conflict. Sometimes we want what is not always the best for us, and there are times that we long to hold on to the things we should let go of. There are times when really the best thing we can do is just pray, "Thy will be done." In these moments, dear God, we are so very thankful for the lessons of your Son, Jesus Christ, for teaching us the words to pray when our own words are insufficient. For our tradition teaches us that Jesus said to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen."
Good morning. Can I have all my kiddos come up? Oh. Y'all come this way. Come sit down. Oh, you can. You've got to be my hand holder. You're my best hand holder. You lost two teeth? That is so cool. Oh my goodness. Goodness. Okay. Well, listen, we'll talk about that in children's church, but let's do children's time first. Can we do that? All right. So listen to this. I do to-do lists. Do you know what a to-do list is? Doing chores. Most of my to-dos are doing chores. You're right. So sometimes my to-do list might say, oh, I need to do laundry and I need to clean the house and I need to take somebody to baseball and I need to do this and that. But sometimes I have fun things on my to-do list, like I need to go swim in the pool, right? Sometimes, listen. Sometimes when on our to-do list, we have things that are fun and things that are not so fun. And we sometimes make excuses for the not so fun things. Kind of like yesterday, my to-do list was to clean the house, but we played in the pool all day instead. And my excuse was, well, it's pretty outside and it might not be pretty tomorrow. So that was my excuse. Well, back in the day when Jesus was around, he was asking people to follow him. And he told them it was going to kind of be hard to follow him because they had to, like, leave everything and they had to sometimes sleep on the ground, sometimes, you know, only have a little bit of food, things like that as he followed. And there were people that made excuses that they couldn't follow Jesus right then. They had to go back and they had to, you know, see their family. They had to go back and clean the house. They made all sorts of excuses. And I think sometimes we make excuses on when we're not following Jesus the right way. Sometimes I think that it's hard to do the right thing and to follow Jesus, and we make an excuse with it, and that's not the right thing to do, is it? We should always follow Jesus, right? And on your to-do list, I think Jesus would be okay with to-do lists as long as it says follow Jesus first on the to-do list, and then we'll go down the to-do list. Deal? I think so. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for these amazing kids. Help us to continue to follow you even through the hard times. Help us to know that you're always there with us. In your name we pray. Amen.
As we prepare to give God his tithes, our offerings, let us go to him in prayer. Gracious God, Jesus promised his disciples the gift of the Holy Spirit, a gift that remains as powerful and as transformative today as it was on that first Pentecost. With generous and thankful hearts, we offer our gifts to you, our time, treasure, and talent. But most of all, God, we offer you our hearts. Use us and these offerings for your purposes and glory. Through Jesus Christ, amen. Come and give your gifts to the Lord.
Say,
when I'm there in your glorious presence. Every knee is bowed before you. Hear the sound of heaven singing, you are worth it all. All the saints cry, holy, holy. Angels singing, worthy, worthy. Forever I will shout your praises, you are worth it all. Everything I've lost,
I have found it.
When I finally reach the end, I'll say, you are worth it all. You are worth it all.
You are worth it all.
Thank you. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to the Gospel of Luke, the 9th chapter, the 51st verse through the 62nd, or you can look up on the walls and read as we hear the Word of God. As the time approached for him being Jesus, to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. And he sent messengers on ahead who went into a Samaritan village to get things ready for him. But the people there did not welcome him because he was heading for Jerusalem. When the disciples, James and John, saw this, they asked, Lord, do you want us to call fire down from heaven to destroy them? But Jesus turned and rebuked them. Then he and his disciples went to another village. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Thanks be to God for the hearing of his word. Amen. How good are you at predicting the future? Anybody? Yeah, when COVID-19 came and hit our country back in March of 2020, a lot of us thought, well, maybe a couple weeks we'll be at home. Do y'all remember that? We will be back in our churches and at work and school. I mean, at least by Easter we'll be back, right? Did y'all remember thinking that, feeling that? Boy, did we miss that one, didn't we? Most of us did make it back by Easter in 2022, 21, maybe. Yeah, we didn't get that one right. Our vision of a quick pandemic was not the most boneheaded prediction of all time, though. All through history, we have been making predictions that and assessments of what the next good step in life should be. And inevitably, life throws us some curves, and that's not the next good step, is it? Washington Post columnist named John Kelly listed a number of real stinkers throughout time. He starts with 1486, the Royal Committee gathered in Spain, and they told the king and queen they should not finance Christopher Columbus. They said it's going to take at least 3 years to sail to Asia the way he's going, and it's going to be nothing there but ocean. Why would anyone want to spend that much time on the ocean? I can understand that. But the king and queen decided to fund Christopher Columbus, and he sailed, and he landed in the Bahamas in October of 1492. And the rest is history, isn't it? We've been globalizing our world ever since. Sometimes at severe human cost. Indigenous people have suffered greatly because of the expanding of the world. And we're still dealing with globalization. But there definitely were things of value between Europe and Asia. The value of land has always been hard to predict. About 400 years after Columbus, a congressman from New York by the name of Orange Ferris was raising Cain because the U.S. was going to pay Russia $7 million, $7 million for the territory of what? Anybody know? Alaska. I think it came out to 2 cents an acre. Pretty good deal. What could possibly be worth that? I remember the Board of Ordained Ministries, one of the questions they asked us incoming ministers was, what is your emphasis in ministry? Are you going to be pastoral or prophetic or evangelical? What is your emphasis going to be? And I remember saying, pastoral. Had no interest in the prophetic. Came to find out and experience that you couldn't be pastoral without being prophetic. You have to tell people things they don't want to hear, the truth. A truth that changes their lives. You have to speak the truth. In the Gospel of Luke today, Jesus knows exactly where he needs to go in life. He wasn't like me and misguided. Jesus sets his face to go to Jerusalem. The importance of that city to his ministry and to his mission is without question. It was clear to him. But there was confusion on his way to Jerusalem, causing his disciples and a number of potential followers to make some problematic predictions of what it means to follow him. First, two disciples enter a village to set up the hospitality and attempt to arrange a place for Jesus to stay. And the Samaritans there, they're not real thrilled at the idea of Jesus coming because he's on his way to Jerusalem. James and John see their sense of rejection of Jesus, and their reaction to say to him, "Lord, do you want us to call fire from heaven and consume them, to destroy them?" They're convinced that Jesus would want the complete destruction of any who reject him. Kind of sounds like stuff I hear today. If you don't agree with me, then you're going to hell. Anybody ever felt that about somebody? Truthfully. And you almost want to say, who died and made you God when they have that attitude? The prediction of James and John is problematic. Jesus is not interested in destroying people. So he turns to James and John. He rebukes them for their destructive impulses. And then the disciples and Jesus just move on to another village. Maybe we can take a lesson in following Jesus. When we meet rejection, just move on. The desire to use violence in the name of God is not unusual. If you look at the history of mankind and Christianity for the last 2,000 years, we've been a pretty violent group of people. Christians used imprisonment and execution to combat heresy. In the European witch trials, they flogged and they exiled people, and those were common punishments to people. And even today, we as Christians use violence against other religions and secular groups and even other denominations. How is that following Jesus' example? Researchers have found that violence is often related to our emotions. Anybody want to be violent, just knock someone down? Usually because you're angry, am I right, or afraid? Because of our emotions. James and John were angry at the Samaritans for rejecting Jesus. David Chester, who's a professor of psychology, has found that even our positive emotions, the good feelings, lead to aggressive behavior. When we feel power, when we feel dominance, they drive us towards violence. It's not just about I'm angry or I want to hit someone, Chester says. It's about how it feels good. How it feels good sometimes to get revenge on someone. Unfortunately, I can relate to that. There are times, I think I could have really hurt someone. It would have felt good. So next time you want to lash out at someone who's treated you badly, or your anger gets the better of you, just think about it. Jesus was not interested in destruction of other people. Jesus isn't interested in that. Next, as Jesus and his disciples were going along the road, a person says, "I'll follow you wherever you go." And Jesus says to him, "Foxes have dens, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." And the guy probably thinks to himself, "Gee, I'd really like to sleep in my own bed. Anybody here like that? I go on vacation for a week. I go see my son for a week in Arkansas. I'm ready to come home and get in my bed. I sleep better in my bed. Are y'all with me there? Gosh. And at that point, he slips away. Yeah, I can remember days of backpacking, sleeping on the ground when I was young, and it didn't hurt. If I did it now, I wouldn't be able to get up. I like to sleep in my own bed. If I can't do that, do I really want to follow you? Another potential disciple says, follow me. Jesus says to him, follow me. The man says, Lord, first let me go home and bury my father. Now, does that seem reasonable to you? It does to me, except the fact his father probably wasn't dead yet. He was postponing or making excuses. I mean, after all, the Ten Commandments say to honor your father and mother. But Jesus' response is, let the dead bury their own. But as for you, go and proclaim the good news. The kingdom of God is here. And the man doesn't know how to respond, so he kind of slips away. Sometimes that's the way it is. God asks us to do something. We're not sure that we can do it, and what do? We kind of slink away. And finally, another potential follower says, I'll follow you, Lord, but let me first go home and say goodbye to my household, my family. Again, a reasonable, respectful request. A quick goodbye to our loved ones so they just won't think we went missing. And Jesus says, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. His request is denied. The first man envisions a place of rest. The second assumes he'll be able to bury his father. The third one is anticipating a chance to say goodbye to his family. All these are reasonable expectations. So why does Jesus consider them to be problematic? Because they're all requests we would probably make ourselves, wouldn't we? All three of these potential disciples failed to see that a future with Jesus is going to be so different than the world we know today. The world of following Jesus is completely different than the world we know right now. There's a man that wrote an article in Popular Science back in 1904. He's talking about airplanes. And he said, the machines will eventually be fast. They will be used in sport, but they will not be thought of as commercial carriers. I think there's something like 100,000 flights every day as commercial carriers today. You see, Jesus is calling us to look forwards to a way of life, one that is hard for us to predict with any accuracy. And in the very next chapter of Luke, Jesus gives 70 of his followers a set of commands. telling them to carry no purse, no bag, no sandals. Whenever you enter a house, first say, peace to this house. Then eat what is set before you, cure the sick there, and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. When Jesus looks into the future for your life and mine, he sees the kingdom of God coming near to us. That doesn't mean comfortable beds, respectful funeral arrangements, or satisfying family visits. He envisions a future that is very difficult for us to predict and even to live. Because it's a future that's created by God, not us. It doesn't mean there is nothing we can do to build the kingdom of God. We can't build it by our own efforts, writes N.T. Wright, a biblical scholar. But we can build for the kingdom. Every act of justice, every word of truth that you speak, every creation of genuine beauty, every act of self-sacrificial love will be reaffirmed and it'll be a building block for the kingdom of God. The acts do not have to be shocking in order to be significant. A cup of coffee given to a homeless person, a piece of work done honestly and thoroughly, prayer from your head and your heart. These are significant acts of building the kingdom of God. Look into the future. We who claim to be followers of Jesus often fail to see what he desires for us. Like James and John, we assume that Jesus wants to destroy people who reject him. Like the potential followers who said they would follow him on the road, we cannot envision discipleship that will disrupt our lives. But being true disciples is a very much a disruption of normal life. The truth is, our assumptions and predictions will cause problems for us in our everyday life, unless they are in line with the coming of the kingdom of God. If we act in ways that are a response to the words of Jesus, then we'll be building blocks for the kingdom of God. Treating one another with love, respect, and caring in the way Jesus cared for others. And sometimes that's not as easy as it sounds, but it's a call to follow. Will you follow him? We've got a song to sing, and as we sing it, think about what it means for you to follow Jesus and how that might disrupt your life but make it better.
Let's all stand together and sing.
riches beyond all measure could never satisfy my heart. Even the greatest pleasure only gratifies in part. All that this world would offer could never pair to all you are. You are my greatest treasure, the desire of my heart. Whatever it cost me, I gave it up freely. Whatever you ask me, I gladly release. All that I have is yours to begin with. Lord, I surrender. Covering blemishes and stains, seeking this world's affection. Empty pursuit, it's all in vain. Jesus, you know and love me. I'm precious because you say I am. Your scars rewrote my life story. Mercy I'll never understand. Oh, whatever it cost me, I'll give it up freely. Whenever you ask me, I gladly release. All that to begin with, Lord, I surrender. I give you my heart. Oh, Jesus, my treasure, you are enough for me. Thank you.
this place, inspired to serve one another, go empowered by God's love to do so. Go from this place to care for one another in the love of God. Go from this place and share His love with all you meet.